name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. This is truly the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It was dead silence. Not rejoicing. I have just a few announcements this morning. Advent will begin on the 29th. Asking for a trustees meeting on November the 15th after worship. And we'll just discuss those two or three issues that we need to take care of. And that'll be it. So it should be a relatively short meeting unless there's a lot of discussion. There's a tutoring sign-up sheet on the second table there. So if anybody's interested in signing up for tutoring, I'd like to begin that on the 1st of December. I'll get the word around and we'll take care of that. Chase Farm Ministries is still in need of goods. And are there any other announcements that we made? I'm used to going to the Lord in prayer first, so we'll go to the Lord in prayer and we'll take care of birthdays and anniversaries and so forth. So let's pray. Gracious and glorious God, we just give you thanks for this beautiful day that you created just for us. We give you thanks for all who are here. You are a blessing to God. So God can bless you. We bless God. And so gracious God, we ask that you just pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Keep us safe. All in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's see here. We have birthdays for this week. This coming week, it's Nikki Clayton. Dibby's on the 13th. Dibby Clayton. And then Bobby's is next week on the 19th, and Dory and Noble, and we'll celebrate their birthdays then. So let's celebrate the birthdays that we have for this week. So let's sing happy birthday to the expense. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Let's say
That's it. That's all right. We're celebrating. We're celebrating. Let us join together in this historic confession of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence shall come the judge, the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we come before your throne with grace and mercy. With some trepidation, but you have told us we need to approach you boldly, that we need to approach you without fear, that we need to offer ourselves to you, gracious God. And we have concerns this morning, and you tell us we need to offer them as well. So I offer you up Jackie, you know what happened to her this week, and you know Alice is going in for a procedure on the 12th. And we want to remember each and every person who's on our prayer list today, and all those that are lifted up in our hearts to you. We ask you, gracious Heavenly Father, to bless them. Pour out your Spirit upon them. And we celebrate this day. This day is Veterans Day, and we celebrate all our veterans. And we ask a blessing upon them. Hear our prayers. Hear the concerns and the burdens of our hearts. Hear our joys and hear our sorrows. All in Jesus' name. It is in Jesus' name that we offer this prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Do we have any veterans with us this day? Would you please stand and let us celebrate you? We thank you for your service. Let's now prepare ourselves to worship God with tithes and offerings. So the ushers will please come forward.
So Jesus said that if somebody who did it did harm to the sheep, but not climb over the fence or climb over, get in the cage without a shepherd on the guy, he would get the person who came into the cage. And you know, sheep know the shepherd before. Have you ever heard that? That the shepherd has such a strong relationship with the sheep that they know his voice and they'll come and follow him. And so if a stranger came, the sheep would probably try to run away from him. I know my cat does that. My cat would come when I follow. But if somebody else, the cat didn't know, it would probably hide or run away from him. My cat didn't watch from him. Somebody comes to the house, but the cat didn't know the cat would go. You have a cat? No. Well, if you did, this cat was coming to you, it would have come to me if I should have had your house or something like that. But anyway, Jesus was telling the story because we are Jesus' sheep. And Jesus is the shepherd. And we know Jesus' voice. And we'll come to Jesus' voice. And we'll follow him. If a stranger came, it would be to kind of take us away from him. Jesus' call, but we listen to him. We don't know the voice. You know Jesus? So we follow him. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that we can follow Jesus' voice. We know his voice. We know his name. We know his will. So gracious God, pour out your spirit and bless us. In Jesus' name. Thank you very much. No, I wasn't as good as Jack.
We are continuing our journey through the Lord's Prayer. We're getting toward the end. I'm doing three of the ones that concern us humans, and I'll do the other three next week. And then guess what? I'm going to be taking a break. Jackie's going to be preaching the Thanksgiving service. So I'm looking forward to hearing her preach. If you have your Bibles with you, but if you just want to look up on here on the screen, I'm going to be reading from Exodus 20, beginning with verse 12. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not steal. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. We have been journeying through the Ten Commandments. Now we come to how we treat one another in community. Previously, the commandments all focused on God and our relationship with Him. The whole focus of the Ten Commandments is relationship. Why? We are designed for relationship with God and with others. We are designed to be in community. We are what sociologists call social animals. You know, there are animals that are herd animals, and there are animals that are single animals. We are animals that are herd animals. We like to live together. We like to live in relationship with one another. Scripture defines our relationship with God through Jesus, who opened the way to the Father by his death on the cross of Calvary. Now God knocks on the door of every human heart. If you open the door, you can claim a relationship with God. So we come down to the fifth commandment. Exodus 20:12. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God has given you. Let us look at the word honor. To honor someone is to treat them in a special way. We should always treat our parents in a special way. For you children out there, you will always be your parents' child. Doesn't matter how old you are, you're still going to be your parents' child. You are to pray for your parents, to help them, to forgive them. Remember what I said, that you are always their child. And if they treat you like a child and you don't want to be treated like a child, forgive them for that, because they're still your parents. You're to bring them joy. You are to love them. Treat them like they're the most important thing in your life. Remember that your parents will not always be around to embarrass you or to give you grief when you do something stupid. Also, remember, no matter what you may do in life, for good or ill, your parents will always love you and forgive you. Listen to someone today say, the older I get, the smarter my parents get. You know, when you were in your 20s, you thought your parents were probably the stupidest people on earth. They didn't know nothing. Well, when you got to be 30, and your parents suddenly got smarter. You got 40, and they got brilliant. Because they had been through the same things that you are going through, or have been through. We all make mistakes. Perhaps we don't visit as often as we should. We may take advantage of our parents at times. Let us remember. Your mother and your father gave you life. They should be honored and revered. Let us work on those relationships while we have time. Remember, parents are not perfect either. So we need to forgive them for their shortcomings. There will come a time when parents will need you. The parent will become the child, and they will need you. My mom and dad are gone now, as many of y'all's are. And I miss them to this day. Well, now let us move on to the sixth commandment. Sixth commandment comes to us from Exodus 20:13. You shall not murder. There are six things the Lord hates, and seven things the Lord finds detestable, as outlined in Proverbs 6:17. There are six things the Lord hates, and seven that are detestable to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community. Now thou shalt not murder and thou shalt not steal. Jesus covers these next two commands. Jesus discussed in the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount, we see Jesus making demands of the law even more demanding for the Christian. Matthew 5:21 says, you have heard that it was said for those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be in danger of judgment. But I say to you that whoever is angry with his brother or sister, without cause, shall be in danger of judgment. Jesus also spoke of intent. Intent is what is in the heart and mind of a person. Intent is the difference between first and second degree murder. Jesus says that if you sin in your heart and in your mind, it is the same as doing it in real life. Remember the Old Testament, the law was an eye for an eye or a life for a life. That is why cities of refuge were set up so a person accused of a crime could flee and seek sanctuary. It was to give the person who was coming after them time to think. It's oftentimes when we do something out of haste, it turns out negatively. In medieval times, a person could flee to the church and claim sanctuary, claim refuge. In the movie The Hunchback of Notre Dame, Quasimodo, swinging the church bell, crying out in glee, sanctuary, sanctuary, sanctuary. After Quasimodo had snatched Esmeralda from the gallows, he took her into Notre Dame Church and deposited her in the church sanctuary, where she could be temporarily safe, at least until her crime had been investigated. We move on to killing. There are some exceptions to killing, such as capital punishment, war, defense of family, but not every killing is understood to be allowable. Like when innocent civilians are killed in a war, it's called flat out murder. I had a friend who had fallen in Vietnam. He came to me one day and asked if God to forgive him for what he had done during the war. I told him God could and had forgiven him. We talked and prayed together for a long time. Survivor's guilt is something that affects many veterans. And I recommend that a veteran get professional help beyond what I can give or what any pastor can give. There are people who have far more training, far more experience than I did. I worked with a veterans group for a while and asked the veterans what they needed. And they said, a pot of coffee and a place to talk. Just to sit and to talk. And to share their experiences. It really, really helped. Murder is taking a life that is always wrong. It often depends on the intent of the person. If it was done by accident, such as a traffic wreck, or if it was planned and done in malice, as Jesus taught in Matthew 5:21. We now move to the seventh commandment. This commandment deals with stealing. The New Testament says this, Ephesians 4:28. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer. You must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. I think that's really neat. But that is found in the Bible. That we must stop stealing if we steal. No, we must be profitable with our hands to share with one another. Now, Exodus 22 says this, whoever steals a man or a woman and sells him, and anyone found in possession of him or her shall be put to death. People do not despise a thief if he steals to justify his appetite when he is hungry, but if he is caught, he will pay sevenfold. He will give all the goods of his house, but if the sun has risen on him, there shall be blood guilt for him. Stealing is bad, and all decisions have consequences. Stealing goes against the will of God, but there are always exceptions. There are reasons for stealing as according to the Bible. One reason is to live. taking of food for survival is permissible in the Bible. Proverbs 6:30-31 says, "People do not despise a thief if he steals to satisfy his hunger when he is starving. Yet if he is caught, he must pay sevenfold, though it cost him all the wealth of his house. In some ways, our laws are not as harsh when judgment is rendered. Yet in other ways, it is very harsh." Next week, we'll be looking at the next three commandments. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Things that we know, but it's good to be reminded.